Well, welcome to Trauma, Its Impact and Implications for Recovery. This is a continuation of the previous lecture on joy and joy strength. My name is Dr. Jim Wilder, and I work as a ordained minister and a licensed psychologist at a counseling center in Van Nuys, California called Shepherd's House, where we have been working for about 29 years as a staff, and for at least the last 15 years we have focused on the areas of severe trauma related particularly to sexual abuse, early childhood abuse. And during that time we were the first Christian counseling center in the area to deal with the area of child abuse victims as adults. And so we worked in that particular area for quite a few years now. Since we were the only counseling center doing it, we had over 200 churches referring to us, the people from their churches that had incest or sexual abuse in childhood. And so if you get 200 churches, you realize that what happens is that the pastor will counsel those that he can counsel, and then those he can't, he refers to the counselors within that church. And the people who prove to be too difficult somehow to handle within that context get sent on to some other center. And at that center, they get funneled to our center because we were the only one working on the issue. So we had, at one period in time, we were seeing over 1,200 appointments a month, the majority of them being for some kind of incest or sexual abuse. We were, in fact, at that point in time, the busiest counseling center in the San Fernando Valley of Los Angeles. And we were seeing all people dealing with this kind of severe trauma. Not surprising that out of that cluster, we ended up with a lot of people with what was called at that time multiple personality disorder, now called dissociative identity disorder. And as a result of having so many of them, I think the average person at our center, and at that time we had a team of about 12 people working on dissociative disorders, was seeing 5 to 15 people with dissociative disorders of one sort or another. From that bunch, the worst cases were sent to me because of two factors. One is I was the one of the most trained people on staff. I had the more degrees behind my name. And so when other people felt that the case had gotten too difficult for them, they would send it on to me. Now, most of the counseling at that time, since most of the sexual abuse cases were women, was being done by women, because it's considered that women should counsel women for sexual abuse issues. But some of the cases, the women said, this person is in such bad shape that it really doesn't matter anymore whether they see a man or a woman, and they sent them on to me. So you'd see I'm at the very small end of a very large funnel. You start with those 200 churches, and you narrow it down to the worst cases that even our staff couldn't handle being passed on to me. The second reason that it was passed on to me is very interesting, to me at least, and that is because of my experience as a missionary kid. I grew up in South America during a time of violence and persecution. During the first 10 years of my life, there are approximately 250,000 people murdered in the area where I live. And so we are familiar with violence, persecution, and a real outpouring of evil. And the one thing that taught me was that God is able. And so for whatever reasons, this unsinkable faith that God had prepared me for said that whatever he has sent these people to me about, though I might not understand what's going on with them and what's being done, for some reason God has me here. And whatever he wants to do by having me here will be accomplished. And the second thing that I realized was from growing up in a church under that kind of persecution was that none of them were trained. None of them were, most of them couldn't read. But they were able to somehow be the body of Christ to each other. And so I knew that somehow in the middle of being the body of the Christ to people who have been through some of the most awful experiences in the world, there is the possibility of becoming who God meant you to be. Well, that's a good place to start for me. And so as a result of that, we began to look very seriously at trauma. And it's out of that context that much of what we're talking about here is developed. Very nice to work with a staff of people, because although I would estimate that probably each one on staff in the first 2 years that we began working with this probably invested at least 1,500, probably closer to 2,000 of our hours of studying individually on this subject. If you put together 8 or 10 people studying 2,000 hours within that amount of time, going through all the literature, all the information, all the scripture, all the tapes, all the conferences, you can get a lot of things also funneled down to one point in time of all that's been known and seen and learned. And what we discovered was that the best secular solutions, surprise, surprise, were not producing real healing and change in people's lives. At best, they were maintaining where people were, keeping them from getting worse. And one of the largest secular authorities on the subject of dissociative disorders declared that the condition really was untreatable, in the sense that you couldn't really achieve a change. You could at best kind of contain this mess in a little way. Well, it wouldn't be too surprising to you after listening to the first lecture if you came to realize that the people who were sent to me were not only the people who had been traumatized very badly, but the people who had also failed to bond or attach to anybody in their lives. And so I began to be the person who was at the center of a lot of unbonded, unattached, very, very traumatized people. It gave in me that intense desire to know what was the way out of this. And so in that context, the deep passion to understand what we're talking about was born inside of me. Some of you, I sense and know from your conversations, have walked some kind of similar path than this. You may not have been at quite as close to the center of the funnel as I got placed. And so I'm giving you the perspective from where it was really pretty intense, in the hopes that you might be able to gather the results of these thousands of hours of facing suffering and somehow benefit from what we experienced there. We had a psychiatrist consult with us, and he said that the average case at Shepherd's House was worse than the worst case in any other place that he had consulted with in Los Angeles. And since Los Angeles is already a pretty weird part of the world, this is, I thought, saying something. So what have we learned about trauma and recovery there? Well, one of the things that we discovered was that trauma has an effect on memory. And because the whole conflict over memory is so closely tied to the discussion of trauma, we need to start with that. Memory, as you might guess, is actually related to the brain and its functions. There's a physical component, very strong physical aspect to memory. So we can't discuss memory without talking about the brain somewhat. Memory is remembering who we are so that we can act like ourselves in the future. I believe that's the purpose for memory. It's a record of who we are so that we can act like ourselves in the future. And so to the degree that our memory is distorted by lies about ourselves, we do not act like ourselves in the future. To the degree that information about us is missing, we are unable to act like ourselves in the future, because we do not have a statement, any kind of image of who we are. But lest we think that memory is a unitary phenomenon, that there's only one kind of memory, we need to start by looking at what actually is going on as a neurological level when we talk about memory. It is actually easier to say that there are a lot of different kinds of memory that take place within our nervous system. There's only one of them that we typically think of as memory. The typical one means what we would call as sort of a intentionally recalled autobiographical kind of memory. That is, I think back and I remember something about my life. I can remember that there was a break here earlier, and I talked to some people, and we did things like that. And I think of that because I'm intentionally trying to remember that. And so that is an explicit memory. It's a memory that I pull back because I want to, and now that I don't want to think about that, I'm going to forget about it for the rest of the lecture. However, I had a nice drink of lemonade right there. And in order to drink that lemonade, my mind also had to remember a whole lot of things about how to hold a glass, how to stand while I'm drinking, how to swallow, all of those kinds of functions, none of which I can recall where I got it from. But unless I had remembered that, I would have not only spilled a drink over myself, if I was fortunate, but I would have probably fallen right on my rear end while trying to do so. And so personally, I'm very satisfied with that part of my memory, even though I can't recall where it came from. And that's an implicit memory. It is retrieved by my body's request without any conscious knowledge of where it came from. And as far as I know, I wasn't remembering how to hold that glass. I was just holding the glass. There's no differentiation between the experience now and the memory from the past. Well, these different kinds, those are the two simplest kinds of memories that we're going to talk about. And the brain has many other kinds of memories that we could talk about. There's short-term memory, long-term memory, intermediate kinds of permanent of memory. There's permanent memory. All of those kinds of real technical details, which are sort of irrelevant to most of us unless we're actually in an accident or something that disrupts that. But we want to talk about the memory process, starting with the most technical part of all, and that is how information is processed by the brain. Well, in order to make this tolerable, I've had to come up with an analogy that helps me think about it, that might need it. Central receiving is what basically notifies the rest of your brain, we got some information for you here, and we're sending it on. Central receiving will take information from either inside your body, like it'll tell me where my knees and legs and stuff like that are right now, so that as I'm standing and waving my arms, I am not losing balance or losing track of where I am or smacking the microphone or something like that. It's saying your arm, I'm getting information from your arm, from your knee, all that sort of stuff. I'm not paying much attention to it really consciously, but central receiving is taking care of that. It's also taking care of the information that I'm receiving from you out there and looking at my notes when that comes along. And it tells my brain there's information coming in you need to pay attention to. From there, the information is sent to the amygdala, which I call the guard check. It's over the information coming in and says, it's okay, or wait a minute, I think I see a gun, or what it's looking for the most is an angry face. Because the worst information, as far as your amygdala is concerned, is someone's mad at me. That's the scariest thing, an angry human being. And there's little doubt about it if we think about it, that probably the most dangerous thing any of us is going to encounter is going to be an angry human being. We're probably, the amygdala would be well placed to be alarmed by that. Next to it are things like snakes. Sees a snake, the amygdala tends to have a very strong reaction to snakes, not like them. There's some indication it may even be born with a reaction to identify snakes without having ever seen one before. And it certainly is alarmed by what they call a visual cliff or something that looks like right in front of me there's something that's a long ways down. And some of you may have gone to the edge of a building and looked down and your amygdala went, whoa, that was close. This is a long way down. We don't like that. That's built into you. Your amygdala doesn't like that. And that guard check says, I got information coming here that's scary. And there's a lot of things that can be there. Well, the guard shack has had a look at the information. It passes it along to the hippocampus, which is really your brain's library. See a brown, crooked thing on the ground. And I look at that, and my brain says, brown, crooked thing on the ground, what could it be? And the library starts looking up under brown, crooked things. Now, if it happens to pull a file on snake, I'm going to be jumping because, and part of the whether I'll look it up under snake depends on whether the guard shack sent this along with a sign that says dangerous information coming up. Then almost certainly, if it came in with dangerous information signal with it from the guard shack, look out, and I see brown crooked thing, I'm going to go snake. look up under snake. What have I got under snake? But if it came in without an alarm signal, then my brain is going to look under brown crooked things. It might, they say, yeah, long brown crooked thing, the stick's going out a different way. Ah, it's a stick laying on the ground. And what do I know about sticks? Well, they don't bite you, they don't hurt you, unless they're falling on your head, no particular problem here. And they will send, the library then will send this information on to the anterior cingulate. Now, the anterior cingulate is the head librarian. Say, well, we've got this experience, so we think about sticks. We actually find them very useful for whacking dogs. And over here, we find about sticks that we have feelings of sort of general indifference to that, because although you can use them for whacking dogs, there's no dogs around, we just don't really care. So here's the information, there's a stick out there, we don't really care about. You could use it to whack a dog if you wanted to, but you know, it's really not advised. So the head librarian combines all of those thoughts together. Now, when they've done that, they send it to your prefrontal cortex. Question is asked, what is it like me to do with this information? And I say, well, I have a stick out there. I don't care much about it. It's useful for whacking dogs, but it's not like me to whack dogs. I like dogs. They're my pets. Why would I want to do that with it? I'm going to leave the stick on the ground. We're going to go off someplace else and do something, because what it's like me to do is keep walking and ignore that stick. If, on the other hand, I happen to have a use for a stick right then, said, oh, that could also be useful for walking as a walking stick, and that one looks about the right length, I think it would be like me to pick it up and walk. So we have the information processing through the brain in that order. Sort of unremarkable when you think about it. Comes into central receiving, sends to the guard shack for alarms. They send it to the library to look it up. The librarian, the head librarian, gets it then and says, how do we think and feel about this together? Hands it on to you. And here for the first time, with all this information coming in, you get to say, and what would it be like me to do with this information? Well, the information that it looks up in terms of how I feel about the situation and how, what I think about it, is located primarily in different hemispheres of the brain. So if we look in the right hemisphere, we get the information about how I feel about it, my sensory experience of the information that's coming in. Right hemispheric memory. So when I picked up this cup and I was remembering what it was like to hold a cup, I have no sense that I'm remembering something. I just feel like I'm holding the cup. And the same thing would happen to you when you're holding your pen and making a note. You feel like I'm just doing this. You're not saying, oh, I'm remembering now when I first picked up a pen. There's no subjective sense of being recalled. It's more exciting, of course, when you trigger the memory without the event going on at the moment. So if you went in there with an electrode, triggered somebody's brain to trigger right hemispheric memory, they might say, oh, well, I feel like I'm riding a bicycle and the wind is blowing through my hair and I can feel and I can smell and these are the memories. I just feel like it's happening now. And they look around and they say, but I'm not on a bicycle. I can see, but I feel like I'm riding a bicycle. That would be a right hemispheric memory. It's also non-focal, which means, remember the flashlight of a consciousness? It can't be focused on anything. The right memory, hemisphere memory, takes in the whole event, not just what I want to focus on. So it would be aware of everything in the room and my body that was going on at this particular time, not just the particular person that I happen to be focusing on consciously. There is, to this date, not a shred of evidence or study or anything that indicates that a right hemispheric memory can be suggested to a person or implanted in any way. The right hemisphere simply will not focus, will only take it all in, but you can't make somebody remember something that isn't there. What they'll remember is they'll remember you trying to think of, make them think of something that wasn't there. They take in the whole event. So how are you going to make them? Unless you can focus them to where they ignore you trying to put that memory in there. But as long as they're taking in the whole event, they say, oh, I know where that's coming from. So-and-so is trying to make me think something. So the whole experience is there. Right hemispheric memory has this as a characteristic. So you get trauma recovery. You have someone, if they're having a right hemispheric memory come back to them, they are experiencing as though it's happening right now. They might call it a body memory. My body feels as though it's being raped. I'm having the sensations right now that someone's raping me, but I don't. Now, there's no one out here. I opened my eyes. But everything about me feels like this is going on. I'm having a memory. It feels immediate. It feels like it's happening right now. And that kind of memory can't be suggested to anybody. That memory circuit simply won't work that way. And it's also not mediated by the library. So, seemed to be going on, so it was stored in the right hemisphere away from the library. It's not dependent on your brain's library to retrieve these. Now, the brain's library we'll talk about when we talk about the left hemispheric memory. After I want to get exactly that and not something else. It's focal because it's just what I want to pay attention to. It's declarative because I can talk about it. I can say, here's what I want to try to remember, here's what I'm trying to work on, here's what I'm remembering. It comes out of that set of memories in the library that I can talk about. It's conscious. I know you asked me to remember, what was the break like? I remember the break. I do right now. If you ask me tomorrow, I won't remember it because it probably just will go out of short-term memory and I won't have it there. But I might remember some of the little episodes of people I talked with. Your face comes up and you say, hi. And I say, oh, yeah, we talked at the break yesterday. And I'll remember that little episode of it. That's all that I'll pull back. I might not remember what we talked about, and I certainly won't remember your name. Sorry about that. It just goes out. But I'll look on your name tag, so please wear them again tomorrow. Otherwise, I embarrass myself going to, what's your name again? It's very suggestible, this memory. So you can actually say to someone, well, now, when that accident happened, was there a blue car kind of parked over to the side? And they start, blue car to the side. I'm remembering something blue now that you mentioned it. Yeah. Okay, yeah, I think there was. There was a blue car over there. And if I don't remember it today, it's quite possible that tomorrow when I came back, I'll say to you, no, I didn't remember that blue car yesterday, but last night it came to me. There was a blue car. It was a Chevy. Chevy Nova parked over there, license plate, blah, 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 blah. Now, there was no car there at all, but it was suggested to you, and that memory in your brain sort of filled in the pieces because it happened to want to create a story about it. So now you have a little episode and a story. This memory is very highly suggestible. And lots of details can be suggested to it. And furthermore, in studies that have been done on the accuracy of memory, there's no difference in accuracy based on certainty. So that if I'm thinking about a left hemispheric memory and I'm just certain that blue car was there, it's not any more likely to be there than if I wasn't certain that the blue car was there. In other words, these focal memories, you can be totally certain that this is what happened, this is how I remember it, and the details you remember versus the details that you invented, you can't tell one from the other based on certain. Remembering, I was there and I was talking to you. I was there when that. Place, and I can place the time. Autobiographical with a sense of place and time. And that's what we normally mean when we talk about memory. This kind of memory is also cortically consolidated. At age 8, what we had in long-term memory, we're able to convert into permanent memory. Long-term memory lasts about 3 months. Permanent memory we remember always without having to go back to the library. Now we just remember the story. We don't remember the event itself. So some of you can remember back to stories that happened before age 8. And I can remember slides that my parents showed me of trips we'd taken before that age. But at this point, I can't tell you if I'm remembering the slide and the story they told me, or if I'm remembering the event itself. Because having lacked the permanent memory before then, I didn't store a permanent story in story form. Up until that time, in order to get back a memory, I had to go to the library and revive that event. And the library would look it up, they would reactivate everything that you stored during that event, and you'd reconstruct in your mind what the event was. And to do that, you'd have to have all the feelings and the reactions that you had with the event, because it was like sort of experiencing it again. And we know that when we pull back one of these permanent memories, that we can experience them with no emotion at all. We just tell the story. And we can edit out by the story, or we can put in more of the story. We can do whatever we want with the story. It's just a story. And if we want to, we can maybe look for the feelings. We can look in the library. But all we need to have at that point is a story. Now, I'll tell you this much. When a traumatic event has been converted into that kind of memory, where it's now a story that we can edit, and in whatever we want, way we want, we can tell all of it or part of it, all of the traumatic aspects of that event have been removed. The event can be considered completely processed. once it becomes a permanent memory that is in story form. And one of the effects of post-traumatic stress is that it shuts down REM sleep. So people with post-traumatic stress are not able to process during rapid eye movement sleep memories from long-term memory into permanent memory, because that's where the final conversion takes place. So blocking people's sleep is going to block the processing of this kind of emotion. Okay, so we have a little sense now for the two kinds of memory and how information is processed. Let's put that information to work. What are the effects of trauma on memory and information processing? Well, first, I want to say that there's two kinds of trauma. Those type B traumas are the ones that we're used to thinking about. Those are the bad things that happen. So if we are somehow shot by a gun, that's a bad thing that happened. We're not designed for that kind of activity. That's a trauma. The other kind of trauma is the type A traumas are the absence of necessary good things. So that if a person requires a joyful face looking at them in order to develop, and they grow up with no joyful faces, this is also a trauma. It's the absence of a necessary good thing, and it will also produce certain results in someone that keep them from developing those parts that would go along with joy, which by now we ought to have a fairly good idea what they might be. Well, if we go back to the type B traumas, they have a very large impact on our nervous system. And they happen in, this response starts out in the guard shack or amygdala, talking about. There's one on either side. When these get information, while I'm at it pointing at that thing, you might also see a purple area, a large, long purple area. That's the library. When the amygdala gets really upsetting information, the guard shack says, danger, danger, it can do four things. The first we'll call an armed response. It's triggers the sympathetic nervous system, and that some of you might know of as the fight or flight response. It says, we got to do something about this right now. Charges your body with adrenaline. You're ready to charge and go, and we're going to fight this one out. This is, you know, something we just have to be as energized as possible to deal with. The second thing that the guard shack can do is to trigger a disaster shutdown, and that would be done through the parasympathetic nervous system. In other words, it would say the only way to survive this is to shut down all systems and all power and to lay very still and very quiet, and we'll shut everything off and hopefully we'll survive whatever's about to come our way, because there's no way to outrun it, no way to get away from it. All we can do is just be conserve as much energy as possible and maybe we'll make it through this. So they shut down all the systems of your body. The next one is what I call calling out the fire department. Secretes neurohormone called ACTH, which sends down to the adrenal glands, and the adrenal glands then begin to pump cortisol. Now, cortisol, we're going to go into in a minute, is basically a central nervous system solvent. It will actually begin to dissolve your nervous system and the connections that just formed. And it says, whatever you just learned, unlearn it. So it says, you had an experience, let's say you touched the stove, and your brain doesn't want you to learn to touch the stove again. It immediately starts to release this so that your nervous system doesn't say, oh, let's keep repeating that. That was an intense experience. It's like, no, we do not want that one running right now. Dissolve that, erase it, you know, call out the fire department, shut that one down. We don't want to learn that response right there. And so that's the fire department. Then what it does is it will send the significant information onto the library for study. So it says, we have an emergency situation here. We do these one of these three things, and then send the information to the library and say, find out what you have on file about the emergency that we're experiencing here. Now, if the guard shack has been traumatized, it doesn't respond in a normal way. And by traumatized, we mean it's been overwhelmed. Something has come in that's been larger than your joyful identity's capacity to handle, and so it just blew your nice functioning brain circuits into disarray. That's traumatized. And so when that happens to the guard shack, as you find in post-traumatic stress disorder, what the guard shack does, sitting in class, and the teacher is trying to teach you the alphabet. What the teacher is saying comes into your ear. Your ear sends it down to the central receiving. Central receiving sends it up to the guard shack. The guard shack says, you ever heard the letter A before? Got nothing on the letter A. Sends it over to the other guard shack. So you got anything on the letter A? Nothing over here. Send it back. You got anything on the letter A? And they ping pong the information back and forth until they drop it. So anything which is neutral is rendered unimportant by the guard shack. We're only paying attention to really scary stuff. Sorry, that isn't scary. And so all the information that isn't scary gets dropped out. Now suppose somebody across the room is trying to get together a spit wad. Well, that could be scary. Immediately, the guard shack takes that information and passes it on to the library, who then says, oh, we got stuff on spit wads here for sure. Send it up to the head librarian. Got any feelings about that? Oh, yeah, babe, I got a lot of feelings about that and thoughts about that one, too. And we send it up to the identity center, and now we're paying attention to that kid over there with the spit wad. We're all into that. Tracking the scary information, but ignoring the neutral stuff. And the guard shack will hyperactivate to alarming material. That means it really gets a big response whenever something scary comes along, which means that that person's brain then begins to only track the things that they're afraid of. So your mental experience consciously is only made up of things that are scary to you. That's all you pay attention to. Any other information gets dropped out, doesn't even get passed on to your mind. You're only paying attention to the trouble that's going on, in other words. I had one woman who had a hyperactivation to this. She used to go out, be driving along, she'd see a pool hall. That got her attention, so she stopped. Why? Because pool halls are pretty scary places if you're a young single woman. But her amygdala grabbed that one, say, there, look at that. She got her attention, she stopped at the pool hall. She'd go into the pool hall, and she began looking around. Pretty soon she noticed that biker guy on the other side. It looked mean and ugly and big and scruffy, and she'd start watching him because he's the scariest thing in the place. Pretty soon he says, hey, that girl's checking me out. And he says, she notices that he's responding. She's really paying attention now. She can't get her eyes off of him. He's waltzing across the room. Say, hey, how about it? Let's go. And so pretty soon she's out riding out of there on the back of the bike. Scariest progression, you see. And she does it time after time after time. The guard shack is tracking only the scary things in the environment. Missed all the other places she could have gone, all the other people she could have seen. These are the people who, if I was there, that's the place I wouldn't go. The person I wouldn't look at, the person I wouldn't hang out with, the person I wouldn't be interested in, because I wouldn't. That'd be scary, you see. But that's the only thing on the screen, the only thing the radar picked up. It also causes fear. They kept track of all the scary things in life, and they have passed by all the things that are joyful. And what will happen then is if the guard shack gets really alarmed, it'll deactivate. In other words, if your joyful identity is weak, it'll even overwhelm your sense of self. Shut that down. And Broca's region is where we speak. So we suddenly become sort of mute. We just have no words to say. We're just too scared to talk. And so whatever we might have said or thought that might have been helpful is gone. And our thinking brain gets shut down, and we get sent off on simple problem solving now. How do I get out of this mess? Not by acting like myself, but anything that gets me out of here is all I'm interested in. Well, if this condition persists, the brain begins to pump cortisol. That's the central nervous brain that's fresh new growth. it also dissolves that. So during times of high growth of the brain, if you traumatize an individual right then, you not only wipe out what they were just learning, but you also wipe out whatever was just growing right then. And you get a lesion in the brain, a spot of brain that's gone. And so now as we begin to match this with what we were talking about earlier, we realize that you can wipe out certain parts of the brain by traumatizing the individual at the time that part of the brain is growing, which is very significant at certain ages. The current studies indicate that the levels of cortisol are directly related to nerve loss in some parts of the brain, particularly the library. Cortisol that goes on for some period of time. It simply wipes out the brain cells, destroys them. They're gone. Not good for your brain at all. And that's where you keep memories, right there. So it makes very, very spotty memory recall after that happened. I was with a fellow recently, had been married for 50-some years. His wife had suddenly died, and he couldn't remember the month after his wife had died, and he couldn't remember what he'd been doing earlier that day, and his mind, anything having to do with memory, was just not focused, not able to pull anything back. He was swimming in cortisol. His mind could not make the adjustment to this enormous loss and the pain of it, and so anything that was tried to put in memory was immediately washed out. And it was for him a period of almost 4 to 5 months before he had sufficiently gotten through his grief that his cortisol levels came down and he could now begin to form memories again and remember what was going on day to day. Well, you might want to recall that if you don't return to joy at the end of a day, that is to say you let the sun go down on your wrath, your body will begin pumping cortisol and overnight you'll be bathing in this stuff. Not good for your brain. What we're going to look at now is how is managing emotions tied to this kind of trauma? We can see how it would be affecting our memory, but how will it deal with our emotions? It's memory out of here. Got to make sure this doesn't happen again. Our joyful identity has been overwhelmed, and we can't manage this at all. And this happens during the joyful identity growth periods. It wipes out our joyful identity. That joy structure that we were growing gets dissolved and destroyed. That happens, of course, during the 6 to 12 months of age period of time. So traumatize a child during that age, and they will lack a capacity for joy because that part of their brain has been new growth, got wiped out by the cortisol. So you don't want traumas to happen to children in that age range if you want them to have a strong, joyful identity. Well, if it happens during the return to joy period, so that they can't return to joy now from that feeling because there's a trauma associated with it, that brain circuit is wiped out. There was something growing there, it's gone now. It's literally physically missing. If you traumatize a child during the return, the integration of self, the 18 to 24 period, month period of time, when the brain is trying to grow that unified brain structure that returns, says I'm one person while returning to joy from all these different emotions, what happens is that whatever parts were being connected become disconnected. And now you have people who act like themselves with very few of their emotions. In fact, every different emotional state or mood they go into, act like a coherent self. You change moods, you change the reactions, you change very intensely from one sense of being one person to another. But if you wait just a bit longer to the 2 to 3 year period of time, right then is when the librarian is being grown. Now all of us have noticed memory will be usually in somewhere in the age 2 to 3. And that's because that left hemisphere memory depends on the librarian. The library. And the library is only myelinated, it's only developed somewhere around 2 to 3 years of age. And right then it hardwires. Well, now if you disrupt someone's memory circuits at the time that library is getting put together, you have a very interesting effect. they don't remember that they're the same person now when they try to remember consciously from one kind of event to another. In other words, they would act like they were a different person with no memory of who they were or what they were doing when they were acting like a different person. Because the library is now disrupted. There's permanent damage to the library structure that would let you remember that you're the same person in all these different events. Well, we simply call that dissociative identity disorder, or multiple personality. I don't remember I'm the same person when I try to remember me in different events. Over here, I think I'm one person. Over there, there's no connection. The file says that's not the same person. I'm somebody else. Fairly unremarkable bit of library disruption. Well, it's remarkable in the sense that none of us would want it, but it's hardly a mystifying sort of event. It's a very physical phenomena based by traumatizing what was developing right then, pulling that part of the file on out so that that part of your experience isn't unified into the rest of your experience. Lost my spot here. Yes, question. Okay, question is, with the New Age interest and the age regression back to back to birth, which is clearly before the age of two, is that kind of thing physically impossible? And the answer is, in terms of remembering the logical story of your life, you cannot do that, no. You cannot. There's no mechanism with which to retrieve the memories before the library was in place. What you have before then are right hemispheric memories, which are experienced immediately as though they're happening, but there's no conscious sense of recall. So if you're recalling that story, you're making it up, whatever goes back before your library is in place. Yes? Okay, the question is, if I was to develop different personalities at the time that the library is myelinating, how would that form throughout life and cause it to kick in at different points in time? Well, there are a number of conditions that are necessary for that to develop across the lifespan. One is that the child has to continue to be in a non-healing environment, because if there's no way to integrate these parts of experience on an ongoing basis, they will continue to stay separated. And to do that, you have to continually, in some way, overwhelm the guard shack so that they don't ever come back together. But the second part of the second aspect of that is that the development of those patterns is triggered by outside events. The guard shack looks over, again, different specific events trigger it. Yeah, the guard shack looks over something and says, I've got something on file that looks like this problem, and it would activate the part of the library that was related to that, which would be independent from the other. So it's internal, it's external stimuli. That's what we call dissociated pieces, yeah, that are disconnected from each other. Okay, well, I'm going to go ahead with the my notes here. Well, you have Ed? All right. Question about how to deal with those memories that are recorded prior to age 2.5 or the presence of the library, and how we deal with that. And I'm trying to look at this to see if I'm getting to that later in the lecture or not. I might as well answer it here. Yeah, I probably have everyone's attention here, Ed, so I'll go ahead and work on it right now. Mm-hmm. Okay, even though it's precognitive, Ed reminds us, there, the trauma has effect on the brain. That effect is located entirely in right hemispheric memory, which, as you recall, is non-focal and has an immediate sense of being recalled. So when that memory is activated, which it is by later events, anything that similar to that event activates the memory, just like my picking up the glass activates the memory of holding glasses. Anything that's similar to that event activates it. It comes back to you in the form of an immediate experience. It feels like it's happening again now. The only problem is there's no record in my library of this ever having happened to me. And it's impossible to have a record of it in the library of ever having happened to me. What you have then is a process, which we'll go into more in a little bit when I talk about, get past a couple more things that develop in the brain, of trying to get your left hemisphere to look at what's in the right hemisphere and decide how to put together an accurate story that would explain what's happening to you right now. In other words, you need to get a truthful story about what your right hemisphere is telling you and convert that into a story form. But you do that in a very much a sort of a detective sort of a way. You say, okay, here's the information I have, I'm observing. And when you have a resolution to that that matches both the left and the right hemisphere, your mind will be at peace and at rest about that. But that, to be explained that, we have to get a little bit farther down. Bodies at the same time with really no connection between them. So what's going on in the right hemisphere is its own business. What's going on in the left hemisphere is its own business. But once this main information track between the two of them myelinates, information can be exchanged back and forth. At this point, what I talk about has something to do with what I feel. Up until that point in time, you can say, talk to a child about their feelings, and your talking to them will have no effect on what they're feeling. They'll stay just as upset as they were if you hadn't been talking to them. Well, they might be able to hold a discussion with you about the subject if they're not too terribly upset, but it doesn't soothe them at all. What actually soothes them is your voice tone or your interaction, your nonverbal communications with them, which might mislead you into thinking that what you're saying actually is having some effect, but it's talking to a disconnected part of the brain. Well, after the point that these two parts of the brain are connected, then we have a chance of combining our right hemispheric memories with our left hemispheric memories. And at that point, we look up any event and we want to say, what did I feel and experience about it? And does it match what I think about it? And if there's a match between those two things that match perfectly, we're at peace with it. And if there is a mismatch, that what I experienced and what I believed and thought about it do not really perfectly match, then we have a discomfort, a distress about it. And that will continue to fester in our minds until we can get those two things to match in a way that truthfully accounts for all that's going on. At this point, if we go move the tape on up to the recovery process, what we're actually trying to do with people is help them to have a left hemispheric story of what happened to them in those first years of life that matches the feelings that they were experiencing at that time. And so in order to do that, you have to do a number of things. One of which is make sure that there's enough joyful identity available to handle the intensity of what you're going to work on and remember, because without the joyful identity, you can't manage to think about this coherently at once. And then you're going to have to find a process that leads you into truthfully dealing with what is the truth, or what would be the true story of what happened to me at that time. To do that, you'll take all the information stored in your hemisphere as it comes back, your right hemisphere as it comes back, and the guidance of the Holy Spirit on the other hand, and a process that involves someone usually guiding you who's being very careful not to suggest things to you that weren't there to begin with. Because at this point, when you're reconstructing the story, it's very much like doing archaeology. You want to carefully reconstruct it without adding any details to it. If you're excavating a tell in the Mideast, and you're going down and you're getting into the the early Canaanite levels and all that sort of thing. And as you're excavating, you drop your McDonald's cup inside there. You don't want to go into the excavation next day and say, oh, they had McDonald's back there in the Canaanite period. You see? That's a later addition. You don't want it dropped in. You want to be very careful about those sorts of things. And you also want to make sure that the interpretations that you have are true. And to do that involves the presence of the Holy Spirit in all of these events. So there's an element of care. There's an element of remembering and turning that into a story that is truthful. And once the truthful story has been told, then there's a peace about it, and it converts right over into our permanent memory. And from that point on, we can tell the story without reverting to the feelings. Now, I've shortened up that and left all kinds of details, but that is the brain part of that. Now, the disorders that are connected with this kind of damage, if you have joy ring deficits, in other words, the guard shack gets information before your conscious mind gets involved, it takes over and acts before your will can be involved. Your will, as far as your mind is concerned, is up in your cortex. So they can actually get you to do things without and beyond the control of your will by putting that information and instructions into the guard shack, because the guard shack will give the get the information before you have a chance to get it and choose and get you to have certain responses. So that's where mind control programming is put in. Now, I'm not going to say anything more about that, so don't even ask me questions, because that is a very information-intensive kind of subject. I will say, of course, that the Lord is quite capable of leading people to freedom out of that, too. So, you know, not to worry, but we're not going to discuss it in this conference. Okay. So the amount or the size of the problem that we can deal with is directly related to the size of our joyful identity. How big is your joy bucket? So if you want to deal with those emotions that are related to trauma, you're going to have a big enough capacity to handle that emotion when it comes on out. And to do that, you have to have two things. You have to have a joy bucket that's big enough to handle that emotion, and you have to know, once you got that bucket full, how to get back to joy with that. Otherwise, you can't handle the memory. And what you'll discover, as we discovered along the way, is that many people will have small, I hate to use the word even, small trauma memories come back to them first. Because that's as big as their joy bucket is. And they'll work on those, and it's only as they go along and growing in relationship that they develop a big enough joy bucket and learn how to get back to joy from some of these events in smaller forms before they get on to the really big ones. Now, that often is discouraging to counselors as well as to counselees, and they ask questions like, you know, why does it take so long? Why does it save the worst for last? A variety of things like that. But there's actually very, very good logic to this. There are some things that the mind is actually learning to do. And when we forget that the brain actually has to learn things, even though we might be praying and ministering and dealing with the person, the brain is still involved and it has to actually learn and develop some capacities. Just like it would if we were teaching somebody to walk again after they hadn't been able to walk. You know, you just don't take them out and have them run the LA Marathon. It's just not the next step. Maybe one day they'll get there, but they're going to get that by training their strength on the way up. And so to say that, you know, we're, you know, which is often the case, if you ask me about almost anybody I'm counseling has a traumatic background, I can give you a list of traumas that we know are there, but we just can't get to. What does that mean? Does that mean that it's necessarily blocked demonically? Well, sometimes it is. Does it mean that the person is just doesn't want to do it? Sometimes it does. But also, sometimes it means that there is not the joy capable of handling that feeling, and some of the simple paths to return to joy for that kind of event are not in place. So were that to come in, they would merely be overwhelmed and re-traumatized again. It can't be contained in memory. Once they can remember the event, they can contain it in their memory, however upset they are, you are in at least a position to teach them how to return to joy. Remember what returning to joy is? That means someone is glad to be with me. So at that point, if they have a strong relationship with Christ and they know that Christ is glad to be with them in that event, you're home. At that point, it's simply a matter of knowing how to pray and minister with people effectively. There's no point at that point to, you know, slow the process down, back off anything. That event from that point on is open to clear, complete, total healing, never to come back again, just to be stored as a story of the wonderful thing that Jesus did in my life. But if they can't contain it in their memory, they're overwhelmed, it just won't hold there, they get the flashbacks, but they can't pull it together, you've got a lack of joy or a lack of returning to joy, and almost certainly a lack of joy. So you have to do practically joy building, joy bucket building experiences. Climb Joy Mountain. Be joyful to be together. Get that strength up so that they're able to deal with this when it comes along. Now, the emotions, the central emotions to be regulated by the right orbital prefrontal cortex. These are the main ones that require return to joy circuits. We've talked about them, you know, along the way. If you can handle these, you're practically a home free. These are the ones that are neurologically embedded in your right orbital prefrontal cortex. They're rage, terror. Now, I will just talk very briefly about the first two by saying that those are both energizing emotions. They turn on the fight or flight response, the rage and terror, and they pump adrenaline. You get very energized when you get these emotions. The next three, shame, disgust, and hopeless despair, are parasympathetic emotions. They de-energize you, they shut you off, they call out the emergency response. It just shuts down all systems in your body. And so people who fall into these, often who have no return to joy, will try to move over to either rage or terror as a way out to re-energize themselves. So you often find little footpaths trying to sneak around from shame, disgust, and hopeless despair into rage or terror. If I can at least get angry about it, I can energize myself and get out of this stuck position. Now, for most counselors, the hardest one is hopeless despair. And as I go around the country and consult with people, most often they are stuck because the counselor does not want to go to hopeless despair with them. We think that as counselors, we're here to make people hopeful. The odd thing is that the way that we make people hopeful is by sharing their intense feeling of hopeless despair with them and showing them the way back to joy. Even we find the Apostle Paul talking about his intense sense of hopeless despair. He talks to churches, he said, we had despaired of life. And yet he goes on to talk about how he continued to minister anyway. But he was in hopeless despair. We find Jesus probably in some sense of hopeless despair in the garden. But nonetheless, that didn't stop him at all from acting like himself, just because he felt that way. He was able to go on acting like himself, as was the Apostle Paul. So when we share hopeless despair, we're talking about an emotion. The fact that I feel hopeless despair has nothing whatsoever to do with whether the situation is hopeless. What does hopeless despair mean to your nervous system? And once I tell you this, you will see why it is a very good idea for all of us to get there frequently. Hopeless despair means a very important problem has to be solved with less time and less resources than I have. I got something so big that with the amount of time I've got to deal with it and the amount of resources I have, I can't solve it. I can't deal with it. Your mind responds by saying, overload, tilt, you can't pick up that truck and carry it. Hopeless despair. Say, let's put it in physical terms. Let's say a huge semi-truck lands on your beloved doll. I really hate to have it land on anything else at this point. It lands on your beloved doll. You want to pick that whole semi-truck up and move it over to get your doll out. And your nervous system says, you can't do that. You can't move it. You can't get your doll out of there. It won't go in the amount of time that you have and the amount of energy and resources you have. This is too big for you. Proper response is hopeless despair. Otherwise, you'd go keep trying to do this and you wouldn't register that this is not a good plan. Well now, if we're ever going to be about the work of the kingdom of God, and he's ever going to march us into something that's too big for us to do in the amount of time he has for us to do it, what is the appropriate response? Hopeless despair. We should feel hopeless despair. It is too big for me to do in the amount of time I have and the amount of energy that I've got. What would it be like me to do under these circumstances? Be like me to cry out to God and say, this is just a God-type moment here. This must be the place. This must be the time. You see, he called us to be his witnesses, right? You shall be my witnesses. Now, what does a witness do? Looks, watches, sees what's going on. So, in terms of the most important counseling relationships, the most important spiritual warfare you're ever going to do, you're going to be a witness. You're going to be watching and seeing what God does there. It means it's too big and too hard for you to do in the amount of time involved. Sometimes people have said to me, they've sensed the Spirit of Christ in them in the session. It says, but Jesus is here and he's guiding what's going on right now. And he wants you to know that you don't know what's happening right now. He's just going to take care of this and you'll probably learn something from it. And I sit back and I let the Holy Spirit guide us through this. I've had counselees tell me this. It's not too surprising to me because I run into a lot of things that are too big for me to solve in the amount of time. I ought to feel hopeless despair. I do. It just fits the event. I said, well, this sure makes me feel hopeless. I'm sure glad we've got God. That's that, you know, Dad's here. That's, you know, it's too big for me. This is an appropriate feeling. You see, it doesn't mean the situation is hopeless. It just informs me that me is too small. And very often, the people we're counseling with, me is too small. And when we're going to throw them that life ring, so land right where they are, we're going to go right to them and say, you know what, I understand me is too small. I can feel that too. I can feel that me and you and you and you and me, we're both too small here. What a wonderful thing. We're on the front row seat for what God has got to do. You see, when we're in hopeless despair, this is marvelous. This is kingdom territory. We've stepped out. And so God keeps calling us into hopeless despair. Have you had that in your life? Have you gotten there? Have you said, this must be the place? Because if you don't get me out of this, I'm cooked. Hopeless despair. And out of that, faith. Wonderful response to hopeless despair. But when counselors won't go there, and they try to talk somebody out of it, oh, it's not that bad, oh, it's okay, we, you know, and they're trying to talk them out of it, the life ring just goes halfway. So it's not that bad, I'll just, you know, throw it there, and if you can swim up to that spot, I'll pull you out. We don't have a return to joy. So we return to joy by saying, I'll join you in your hopeless despair. That makes sense. Good stuff, hopeless despair, isn't it? Don't you want to just go out of here and have some? You do if you know how to act like yourself. And if you know that, you want to make sure that everybody else who feels that knows how to act like themselves too. It's good news. You don't want anybody that you ever met not to know the good news of what it's like us to do when we feel hopeless despair. I mean, isn't that, I mean, to me, it just sort of pumps me up a little bit. Of course, I still do like watching somebody else's life illustrate that better than my own. It's uncharitable of me, I'm sure.